Introduction. To the Duchess of Newcastle on her new blazing world. Our elder world, with all their skill and arts, could but divide the world into three parts. Columbus, then for navigation famed, found a new world, America 'tis named. Now this new world was found, it was not made, only discovered, lying in time's shade. Then what are you, having no chaos found, to make a world, or any such least ground? But your creating fancy thought it fit to make your world of nothing but pure wit. Your blazing world beyond the stars mounts higher, enlightens all with a celestial fire. William Newcastle. To all noble and worthy ladies. This present description of a new world was made as an appendix to my observations upon experimental philosophy, and, having some sympathy and coherence with each other, were joined together as two several worlds at their two poles. But, by reason most ladies take no delight in philosophical arguments, I separated some from the mentioned observations, and caused them to go out by themselves, that I might express my respects in presenting to them such fancies as my contemplations did afford. The first part is romantical, the second philosophical, and the third is merely fancy, or, as I may call it, fantastical. And if, noble ladies, you should chance to take pleasure in reading these fancies, I shall account myself a happy creatoress. If not, I must be content to live a melancholy life in my own world, which I cannot call a poor world, if poverty be only want of gold and jewels, for there is more gold in it than all the chemists ever made, or, as I verily believe, will ever be able to make. As for the rocks of diamonds, I wish with all my soul they might be shared amongst my noble female friends, upon which condition I would willingly quit my part. And of the gold I should desire only so much as might suffice to repair my noble lord and husband's losses, for I am not covetous, but as ambitious as ever any of my sex was, is, or can be, which is the cause that though I cannot be Henry V or Charles II, yet I will endeavour to be Margaret I. And though I have neither power, time, nor occasion to be a great conqueror like Alexander or Caesar, yet rather than not be mistress of a world, since fortune and the fates would give me none, I have made one of my own. And thus, believing or at least hoping that no creature can or will envy me for this world of mine, I remain, noble ladies, your humble servant, M. Newcastle. A merchant, travelling into a foreign country, fell extremely in love with a young lady. But being a stranger in that nation and beneath her, both in birth and wealth, he could have but little hopes of obtaining his desire. However, his love growing more and more vehement upon him, even to the slighting of all difficulties, he resolved at last to steal her away. Which he had the better opportunity to do, because her father's house was not far from the sea, and she, often using to gather shells upon the shore, accompanied not with above 2 to 3 of her servants, it encouraged him the more to execute his design. Thus coming one time with a little light vessel, not unlike a packet-boat, manned with some few seamen and well victualled for fear of some accidents which might perhaps retard their journey, to the place where she used to repair he forced her away. But when he fancied himself the happiest man of the world, he proved to be the most unfortunate. For heaven, frowning at his theft, raised such a tempest as they knew not what to do, or whither to steer their course, so that the vessel, both by its own lightness and the violent motion of the wind, was carried as swift as an arrow out of a bow towards the North Pole, and in a short time reached the icy sea, where the wind forced it amongst huge pieces of ice. But being little and light, it did, by the assistance and favour of the gods to this virtuous lady, so turn and wind through those precipices, as if it had been guided by some experienced pilot and skilful mariner. But alas! Those few men which were in it, not knowing whither they went, nor what was to be done in so strange an adventure, and not being provided for so cold a voyage, were all frozen to death. The young lady only, by the light of her beauty, the heat of her youth, and protection of the gods, remaining alive. Neither was it a wonder that the men did freeze to death, for they were not only driven to the very end or point of the pole of that world, but even to another pole of another world, which joined close to it. So that the cold, having a double strength at the conjunction of those two poles, was insupportable. At last, the boat, still passing on, was forced into another world. For it is impossible to round this world's globe from pole to pole, so as we do from east to west, because the poles of the other world, joining to the poles of this, do not allow any further passage to surround the world that way. But if any one arrives to either of these poles, he is forced to return or to enter into another world. And lest you should scruple at it, and think, if it were thus, those that live at the poles would either see two suns at one time, or else they would never want the sun's light for 6 months together, as it is commonly believed, you must know, that each of these worlds having its own sun to enlighten it, they move each one in their peculiar circles, which motion is so just and exact that neither can hinder or obstruct the other, for they do not exceed their tropics, and although they should meet, yet we in this world cannot so well perceive them, by reason of the brightness of our sun, which being nearer to us, obstructs the splendor of the sun of the other world, they being too far off to be discerned by our optic perception, except we use very good telescopes. By which skilful astronomers have often observed two or three suns at once. But to return to the wandering boat and the distressed lady. She, seeing all the men dead, found small comfort in life. Their bodies, which were preserved all that while from putrefaction and stench by the extremity of cold, began now to thaw and corrupt. Whereupon she, having not strength enough to fling them overboard, was forced to remove out of her small cabin upon the deck to avoid the nauseous smell. And, finding the boat swim between two plains of ice, as a stream that runs betwixt two shores, at last perceived land, but covered all with snow, from which came walking upon the ice strange creatures, in shape like bears, only they went upright as men. Those creatures coming near the boat catched hold of it with their paws that served them instead of hands. Some two or three of them entered first, and when they came out, the rest went in one after another. At last, having viewed and observed all that was in the boat, they spake to each other in a language which the lady did not understand, and having carried her out of the boat, sunk it together with the dead men. The lady, now finding herself in so strange a place, and amongst such wonderful kind of creatures, was extremely strucken with fear, and could entertain no other thoughts but that every moment her life was to be a sacrifice to their cruelty. But those bear-like creatures, how terrible soever they appeared to her sight, yet were they so far from exercising any cruelty upon her, that rather they showed her all civility and kindness imaginable. For she, being not able to go upon the ice by reason of its slipperiness, they took her up in their rough arms and carried her into their city, where instead of houses they had caves underground. And as soon as they entered the city, both males and females, young and old, flocked together to see this lady, holding up their paws in admiration. At last, having brought her into a certain large and spacious cave, which they intended for her reception, they left her to the custody of the females, who entertained her with all kindness and respect, and gave her such victuals as they used to eat. But seeing her constitution neither agreed with the temper of that climate nor their diet, they were resolved to carry her into another island of a warmer temper, in which were men like foxes, only walking in an upright shape, who received their neighbors the bear men with great civility and courtship, very much admiring this beauteous lady, and having discoursed some while together, agreed at last to make her a present to the emperor of their world. To which end, after she had made some short stay in the same place, they brought her across that island to a large river, whose stream runs smooth and clear like crystal, in which were numerous boats, much like our fox-traps, in one whereof she was carried, some of the bear and fox-men waiting on her. And as soon as they had crossed the river, they came into an island where there were men which had heads, beaks, and feathers like wild geese, only they went in an upright shape like the bear men and fox men. Their rumps they carried between their legs, their wings were of the same length with their bodies, and their tails of an indifferent size, trailing after them like a lady's garment. And after the bear and fox men had declared their intention and design to their neighbors, the geese or bird men, some of them joined to the rest, and attended the lady through that island, till they came to another great and large river, where there was a preparation made of many boats, much like birds' nests, only of a bigger size. And having crossed that river, they arrived into another island, which was of a pleasant and mild temper, full of woods, and the inhabitants thereof were satyrs, who received both the fox, bear, and bird men with all respect and civility. And after some conferences, for they all understood each other's language, some chief of the satyrs joining to them, accompanied the lady out of that island to another river, wherein were many handsome and commodious barges, and having crossed that river, they entered into a large and spacious kingdom, the men whereof were of a grass-green complexion, who entertained them very kindly, and provided all conveniences for their further voyage. Hitherto they had only crossed rivers, but now they could not avoid the open seas any longer. Wherefore they made their ships and tacklings ready to sail over into the island where the Emperor of the Blazing World, for so it was called, kept his residence. Very good navigators they were, and though they had no knowledge of the lodestone or needle or pendulous watches, yet, which was as serviceable to them, they had subtle observations and great practice. Insomuch that they could not only tell the depth of the sea in every place, but where there were shelves of sand, rocks, and other obstructions to be avoided by skilful and experienced seamen. Besides, they were excellent augurers, which skill they counted more necessary and beneficial than the use of compasses, cards, watches, and the like. But, above the rest, they had an extraordinary art, much to be taken notice of by experimental philosophers, and that was a certain engine, which would draw in a great quantity of air and shoot forth wind with a great force. This engine in a calm they placed behind their ships, and in a storm before, for it served against the raging waves like cannons against a hostile army or a besieged town. It would batter and beat the waves in pieces, were they as high as steeples, and as soon as a breach was made, they forced their passage through, in spite even of the most furious wind, using two of those engines at every ship, one before to beat off the waves, and another behind to drive it on. So that the artificial wind had the better of the natural, for it had a greater advantage of the waves than the natural of the ships. The natural being above the face of the water could not, without a downright motion, enter or press into the ships, whereas the artificial, with a sideward motion, did pierce into the bowels of the waves. Moreover, it is to be observed that in a great tempest they would join their ships in battle array, and when they feared wind and waves would be too strong for them if they divided their ships, they joined as many together as the compass or advantage of the places of the liquid element would give them leave. For their ships were so ingeniously contrived that they could fasten them together as close as a honeycomb, without waste of place, and being thus united, no wind nor waves were able to separate them. The emperor's ships were all of gold, but the merchants and skippers of leather. The golden ships were not much heavier than ours of wood, by reason they were neatly made, and required not such thickness, neither were they troubled with pitch, tar, pumps, guns, and the like, which make our wooden ships very heavy. For though they were not all of a piece, yet they were so well soldered that there was no fear of leaks, chinks, or clefts. And as for guns, there was no use of them, because they had no other enemies but the winds. But the leather ships were not altogether so sure, although much lighter. Besides, they were pitched to keep out water. Having thus prepared and ordered their navy, they went on in despite of calm or storm. And though the lady at first fancied herself in a very sad condition, and her mind was much tormented with doubts and fears, not knowing whether this strange adventure would tend to her safety or destruction, yet she being withal of a generous spirit and ready wit, considering what dangers she had passed, and finding those sorts of men civil and diligent attendants to her, took courage and endeavoured to learn their language, which after she had obtained so far, that partly by some words and signs she was able to apprehend their meaning, she was so far from being afraid of them that she thought herself not only safe but very happy in their company. by which we may see that novelty discomposes the mind, but acquaintance settles it in peace and tranquillity. At last, having passed by several rich islands and kingdoms, they went towards Paradise, which was the seat of the Emperor, and coming in sight of it, rejoiced very much. The lady at first could perceive nothing but high rocks which seemed to touch the skies, and although they appeared not of an equal height, yet they seemed to be all one piece without partitions. But at last, drawing nearer, she perceived a cliff, which was a part of those rocks, out of which she spied coming forth a great number of boats, which afar off showed like a company of ants, marching one after another. The boats appeared like the holes or partitions in a honeycomb, and when joined together stood as close. The men were of several complexions, but none like any of our world. And when the boats and ships met, they saluted and spake to each other very courteously. For there was but one language in all that world, nor no more but one emperor, to whom they all submitted with the greatest duty and obedience, which made them live in a continued peace and happiness, not acquainted with foreign wars or home-bred insurrections. The lady, now being arrived at this place, was carried out of her ship into one of those boats, and conveyed through the same passage, for there was no other, into that part of the world where the emperor did reside, which part was very pleasant and of a mild temper. Within itself it was divided by a great number of vast and large rivers, all ebbing and flowing into several islands of unequal distance from each other, which in most parts were as pleasant, healthful, rich, and fruitful as nature could make them, and, as I mentioned before, secure from all foreign invasions, by reason there was but one way to enter, and that like a labyrinth, so winding and turning among the rocks, that no other vessels but small boats could pass, carrying not above three passengers at a time. On each side, all along the narrow and winding river, there were several cities, some of marble, some of alabaster, some of agate, some of amber, some of coral, and some of other precious materials not known in our world. All which, after the lady had passed, she came to the imperial city, named Paradise, which appeared in form like several islands, for rivers did run betwixt every street, which together with the bridges, whereof there were a great number, were all paved. The city itself was built of gold, and their architectures were noble, stately, and magnificent, not like our modern, but like those in the Romans' time. For our modern buildings are like those houses which children use to make of cards, one story above another, fitter for birds than men. But theirs were more large and broad than high. The highest of them did not exceed two stories, besides those rooms that were underground as cellars and other offices. The emperor's palace stood upon an indifferent ascent from the imperial city, at the top of which ascent was a broad arch, supported by several pillars which went round the palace, and contained four of our English miles in compass. Within the arch stood the emperor's guard, which consisted of several sorts of men. At every half mile was a gate to enter, and every gate was of a different fashion. The first, which allowed a passage from the imperial city into the palace, had on either hand a cloister, the outward part whereof stood upon arches sustained by pillars, but the inner part was close. Being entered through the gate, the palace itself appeared in its middle like the aisle of a church, a mile and a half long and half a mile broad. The roof of it was all arched and rested upon pillars so artificially placed that a stranger would lose himself therein without a guide. At the extreme sides, that is, between the outward and inward part of the cloister, were lodgings for attendants, and in the midst of the palace, the emperor's own rooms, whose lights were placed at the top of every one because of the heat of the sun. The emperor's apartment for state was no more enclosed than the rest. Only an imperial throne was in every apartment, of which the several adornments could not be perceived until one entered, because the pillars were so just opposite to one another, that all the adornments could not be seen at one. The first part of the palace was, as the imperial city, all of gold. And when it came to the emperor's apartment, it was so rich with diamonds, pearls, rubies, and the like precious stones, that it surpasses my skill to enumerate them all. Amongst the rest, the imperial room of state appeared most magnificent. It was paved with green diamonds, for there are in that world diamonds of all colors, so artificially as it seemed but of one piece. The pillars were set with diamonds so close and in such a manner that they appeared most glorious to the sight. Between every pillar was a bow or arch of a certain sort of diamonds, the like whereof our world does not afford, which being placed in every one of the arches in several rows, seemed just like so many rainbows of several different colors. The roof of the arches was of blue diamonds, and in the midst thereof was a carbuncle which represented the sun, and the rising and setting sun at the east and west side of the room were made of rubies. Out of this room there was a passage into the emperor's bedchamber, the walls whereof were of jet, and the floor of black marble. The roof was of mother of pearl, where the moon and blazing stars were represented by white diamonds, and his bed was made of diamonds and carbuncles. No sooner was the lady brought before the emperor, but he conceived her to be some goddess, and offered to worship her, which she refused, telling him, for by that time she had pretty well learned their language, that although she came out of another world, yet was she but a mortal. At which the emperor, rejoicing, made her his wife, and gave her an absolute power to rule and govern all that world as she pleased. But her subjects, who could hardly be persuaded to believe her mortal, tendered her all the veneration and worship due to a deity. Her accoutrement after she was made empress was as followeth. On her head she wore a cap of pearl, and a half-moon of diamonds just before it. On the top of her crown came spreading over a broad carbuncle cut in the form of the sun. Her coat was of pearl mixed with blue diamonds and fringed with red ones. Her buskins and sandals were of green diamonds. In her left hand she held a buckler to signify the defence of her dominions, which buckler was made of that sort of diamond as has several different colours, and being cut and made in the form of an arch showed like a rainbow. In her right hand she carried a spear made of white diamond, cut like the tail of a blazing star, which signified that she was ready to assault those that proved her enemies. None was allowed to use or wear gold but those of the imperial race, which were the only nobles of the state, nor durst any one wear jewels but the emperor, the empress, and their eldest son. Notwithstanding that, they had an infinite quantity both of gold and precious stones in that world. For they had larger extents of gold than our Arabian sands. Their precious stones were rocks, and their diamonds of several colors. They used no coin, but all their traffic was by exchange of several commodities. Their priests and governors were princes of the imperial blood, and made eunuchs for that purpose. And as for the ordinary sort of man in that part of the world where the emperor resided, they were of several complexions, not white, black, tawny, olive, or ash-colored, but some appeared of an azure, some of a deep purple, some of a grass-green, some of a scarlet, some of an orange color, etc. Which colors and complexions, whether they were made by the bare reflection of light, without the assistance of small particles, or by the help of well-ranged and ordered atoms, or by a continual agitation of little globules, or by some pressing and reacting motion, I am not able to determine. The rest of the inhabitants of that world were men of several different sorts, shapes, figures, dispositions, and humors, as I have already made mention heretofore. Some were bear men, some worm men, some fish or mere men, otherwise called sirens, some bird men, some fish men, some ant men, some geese men, some spider men, some lice men, some fox men, some ape men, some jackdaw men, some magpie men, some parrot men, some satyrs, some giants, and many more, which I cannot all remember. And of these several sorts of men, each followed such a profession as was most proper for the nature of their species, which the empress encouraged them in, especially those that had applied themselves to the study of several arts and sciences. For they were as ingenious and witty in the invention of profitable and useful arts as we are in our world, nay, more, and to that end she erected schools and founded several societies. The bear men were to be her experimental philosophers, the bird men her astronomers, the fly, worm, and fish men her natural philosophers, the ape men her chemists, the satyrs her Galenic physicians, the fox men her politicians, the spider and lice men her mathematicians, the jackdaw, magpie, and parrot men her orators and logicians, the giants her architects, etc. But before all things, she, having got a sovereign power from the emperor over all the world, desired to be informed both of the manner of their religion and government. And to that end, she called the priests and statesmen to give her an account of either. Of the statesmen she inquired first, why they had so few laws? To which they answered, that many laws made many divisions, which most commonly did breed factions, and at last break out into open wars. Next, she asked, why they preferred the monarchical form of government before any other. They answered, that as it was natural for one body to have but one head, so it was also natural for a politic body to have but one governor, and that a commonwealth which had many governors was like a monster with many heads. Besides, said they, a monarchy is a divine form of government, and agrees most with our religion. For as there is but one God, whom we all unanimously worship and adore with one faith, so we are resolved to have but one emperor, to whom we all submit with one obedience. Then the empress, seeing that the several sorts of her subjects had each their churches apart, asked the priests whether they were of several religions. They answered her majesty.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.